viewers, welcome to this film, Time Management. Time, as we all know, is among the scarce resources of management. There is thus a need for effectively managing time. The present film is an attempt to highlight the various aspects of time management. It deals with the concept, the myth, and the importance of time. It also outlines the ways of allocating time for different managerial functions. Let us now watch this film.
Since time immemorial, man has been memorializing the time. Different meanings, phrases have been attached to time. Like phrases, time is marching on, or time is a great healer, or whose time has come. Like these phrases have been used from time to time, and sometimes time has been taken as a ravaging power, or other times it has been taken as a passage of the time. The passage of the time or the movement of time has been recorded by the man from very inception of the man kind, and he has been noting the time or recording the time with the help of the shadow on the sundial or sands in the hourglass, or with the help of hands of the clocks, which is nowadays prevalent. Great personalities and experts have attached different meaning to time. Like great scientist Einstein said, this is time is the fourth dimension. So how can we say that time can be made up? We can't make up time in real sense. If a pilot is making up those 30 minutes which he lost in the departure time at Bombay, can be made up only by increasing the speed of the aircraft, which will be consuming in lieu of that more fuel and more of energy and efforts. So that way, time which is lost cannot be replaced or recovered. Secondly, time, we say that time will take care itself, or time is a great healer. Time is not a great healer, but things improve themselves with the passage of time. Another thing is the paradox of time. That is, every manager, every individual, when asked, will say, I don't have time, I have less time, I require more time. But time is such a resource which is moving very constantly, and everybody has got equal time. So all the time is there with all the managers, all the executives. So it is we are lacking in its management, rather than time is not enough with us. Time is equally distributed. This is perhaps the only resource which is equally distributed to all the individuals, all the human beings, or all the people in the universe. Now, time has been regarded as a critical resource. Big personalities of management like Peter Drucker, he says, time has not been included in the other resources of management. What are other resources of management? Four M's, that is men, money, machine, materials. Now, sometimes people include methods also in that. So that is fifth dimension or fifth resource. Sometimes people say MIS also, managing of the information or management information systems. That is sixth. Or people have hardly included this time management dimension as such. Minutes, the seventh M, is to be included in the resources list, which are men, money, machines, materials, MIS, methods, and the minutes. So Peter F. Drucker says that time is the most critical and most scarcest of the resources, which are available to us, to the mankind, and it needs great care to manage the time. There is a lot of relevance to manage the time. So how the time is defined? If we take the dictionary meaning of time, Webster's defined time as the period for which the activity continues or action continues, This is the definition of time. If we talk about the management, then management is, by definition, management is getting things done through others or getting objectives accomplished in an effective manner. That is another definition, or same definition put in different words. So this is time management as such. Different meanings have been attached to time. There is paradox of time, but at all conclusions, this is something very critical resource as such, which the manpower or managers particularly, they should use it very carefully, and hence time management is required. Now there are some myths of time management or myths of time. What are these myths? Myths mean certain untrue things which have been accepted as such. Now we have listed some of the myths here in this chart. This chart says, first one, if you take, this is myth of activity. This says, managers who are the most active get the most done. Now, there may be some managers who are active, who are very busy, but they might be lacking the direction as such. Maybe doing something which may not be needed. So they get involved in the activity and they might be losing the real sight of the objectives, direction of the objective to which they should proceed as such. And that way they might be losing time. Rather than getting most done, they might be losing time and they may not be able to achieve the objectives in a better way. In French vocabulary, it is said that if you are in doubt, gallop. Horses, when you are riding the horse, and if you are in doubt, you gallop. Similarly, you get involved in the activity rather than taking care of the objectives. Or when the time, when your point is weak, you shout. By shouting, you make it more forceful. So that way you get involved in the activities and lose the real sight of the direction, and hence myth of activity. People who are most active, they may not be very good performers as such. Second is myth of decision level. The higher the level at which a decision is made, the better. This is also untrue. This is a myth. What happens that it is our belief that top management or board of directors takes best decisions, makes best decisions, and a lot of information which is relevant to making decisions is available with them, and hence they are able to make best decisions. But this is not true as such, because the grassroots level person who is managing the machine, doing the operations, perhaps decisions made by him will be less costly and will be more effective as such. So we should carry the decisions or make the decisions at the different levels rather than waiting for the top level to take decisions, top management to take decisions. Third is myth of delayed decisions, which says delay improves the quality of decisions. Why? this is assumption. No, manager think that let us delay it, let us postpone it for some time, and we'll be taking it when more information comes. So they keep on waiting for the 80% of the information which never comes. They forget that the 20% of the facts are more crucial, more critical for getting the 80% outcomes. So delayed decision is not a very good decision, but it wastes the time. Fourth is myth of delegation. Delegation saves the time, worry, and responsibility. This is also untrue. This is a myth. Delegation, of course, can improve the decision making or make decision better and save time. But delegation, making the delegation and authorities to be delegated, for that you have to have a lot of planning as such. Without planning, if you delegate, then you will be inviting so many problems, because the subordinates from down below will be coming to you frequently and asking few questions for the clarity of that delegated authority. And hence, wastage of time will be more in that case, unless it is very carefully followed. Delegation principle is very clearly followed. Then, myth of efficiency. Most efficient manager is the most effective. Now, there is a confusion between effectiveness and efficiency. Generally, efficiency is confused with effectiveness. But experts like Peter Drucker say that the person who is efficient may not be effective. Efficiency, he says, is doing a job right, whereas effectiveness is doing the right job right. So that is the basic difference. You might be attempting on a wrong job at the right time, or right job at the wrong time. So you may be efficient, but you may not be effective. Effective person is one who is doing right job at the right time. Then, myth of hard work. Harder one works, the more he gets done. This is also a myth. You have to work smarter than harder these days. That should be the principle, because if you are losing the direction in the hard work and you are working against the objective sometimes, or objectives but losing the sight of the objectives in clear sense, then you may be working harder but may not be achieving that much as the person working smarter and achieving. Then myth of omnipotence. By doing it yourself, tasks are better achieved. This is also untrue. That is, some manager have the tendency to remain present all the time, take all the decisions ourselves, concentrating all the decisions ourselves, that other people, he doesn't trust others, that others, my subordinates may not be able to do it better, and hence they require a lot of guidance. So he keeps on guiding people and keeps himself present for all the decisions. So that way he wastes the time rather than solving the problems, and performance will be lesser. Eighth myth is myth of overworked manager. The persons in the organization or executives in the organizations are generally taken as overworked. They keep on complaining. You might have heard, there is a lot of work in our organization, there is no time. So this is also a myth, that people keep on complaining of overworking because of they lose the sight of the objectives. They keep on working. They sometimes even have the tendency of saying that we are indispensable, or indispensability is there for us. If we are not attending to this organization will not be able to survive. Such is the belief of some people. The managers give their vacations, devote the vacations there in the organization. They sit for the long hours of the day. They work overtime, but in the process, they are not able to achieve the targets. People who are working overtime may not be the best performers. So generally, people are overworked, but they are not very good, effective managers. Myth of open door. Generally, we have the tendencies in our offices, as we as managers, that we keep our door open, open door policy we follow. That is, let everybody come and talk to us, and we should not close doors to anyone. But actually, we need a quiet hour for ourselves, at least 1 hour a day we need for ourselves, so that we can reorganize our ideas and organize for other activities better. But in the open door policy, what happens? That certain corridor wanderers, maybe they may drop in and disturb us, or some people will come to say hello, some people will give a courtesy call. So drop-in visitors will be there so many, and that will be a disturbance rather than indication to better performance. So open door policy is not always better. Myth of problem identification. It is said that if problem is well defined, half of the problem is solved. In research, generally, it is said that half of the research is over if problem is well identified and well defined. But we take it very easy that identification of problem is very easy. It takes a lot of time as to identify the problem. And hence, this also becomes a myth that problem identification is a easier task. This requires a lot of time as such. And of course, if it is identified properly, it solves the problem. If the problem is well defined, that can solve the problem. Another is myth of time saving. Some managers think that if they adopt some shortcuts, they can save time. So in the process, they may be skipping certain things, and their results may get distorted as well. So they may be getting distorted performance in their shortcuts. So shortcuts is not a better way to save time. You have to, it is said that if you don't have time to do the job, when you will be having time to do it over, work it over. So another is 12th myth is myth of time shortage. Generally, every manager is complaining of this thing very frequently, that we don't have time and time is running very fast. But time is equally distributed to all the people. This is perhaps the only resource which is equally distributed to all. So this is also a false version. 13th is myth that time flies. There is a myth saying, generally we keep on saying that time is flying. I don't know what to do now. I have very less time as such. Time, so we don't know how the time is going and it is flying. Time is not flying, but we are not managing it, and that is what the truth is. Then the final is myth that time is against us. Time is not against us, but we are not able to manage it, and in the process, we make time as our enemy. Actually, actual enemy of ourselves are we people only. The enemy is within only, because we are not able to manage the times, time or activities well in time. So this is about the myths of time management. Certain these 14 myths which we have listed here, they are said to be the truths otherwise, but they are myths. They don't give better performance, and maybe requiring more time as such. Now, coming to the second aspect of time management, allocating time to management. Allocating time to management. Now, time and management are not inseparable. They are not separable as such. They are inseparable and intricately interwoven with each other. Time management principles are equally applicable to management, and management principles are applied to time management. So these are interchangeably used things as such. Certain time principles are used in management, and certain management principles are used in time. But allocation of time to different functions of management is a real problem. Now, if we take this transparency, then we see that major performance skills needed at various management levels is listed here. Now, there is a diagram shown like this, in which it has been written conceptual skills, human skills, technical skills. Then top management, middle management, and lower management or supervisory management is listed. If we see the conceptual skills, which is, what is conceptual skill? Conceptual skill is the ability to develop ideas, to deal with the obstructions, to view the organization as a whole, to recognize how decisions in one area affect decisions in the other area. So this is something doing non-recurring type of things. That is, you are thinking something new. So that is the job of the top management. So this is referred to the top management here. That is, conceptual skills are needed more when you are going up in the hierarchy. Top management will be needing more of non-recurring type of skills, conceptual skills, where they are to develop new ideas, they have to see different obstructions in the organization, see the organization as a whole, and see that what effect the other decision areas are having on the other management decision areas. Similarly, we take the human skills. Human skills is needed almost equally. It is equally spread if we see the diagram. And this is referred as leading, whereas conceptual skill has been referred as managing. Top management is supposed to manage the things, manage the organization, whereas the other hierarchical levels, rather all the hierarchical levels are required to lead the people. Even top management requires to have leadership qualities. Middle management is required to have the leadership qualities, or lower management is required to have the leadership qualities. Human skills that way are needed in equal amounts in all the management levels, lower, middle, or top. What are the human skills? Human skills are the ability to work effectively with people, ability of the person to work effectively with other people, team building approach, a team spirit. Thirdly, technical skills are needed maximum at the lower management level, because what is this technical skill? Is the ability to work with methods, procedures, processes, procedures, and techniques. So it is the ability to work with the tools and techniques which are at your disposal. So that is the supervisory management level, and hence technical skill is needed more in that level. Hence the space shown up here is more than space shown at the top. Top level management, because they are not involved in operations. So hence this is shown lesser in this case. They have to give less time to the technical skill, but more time to the conceptual skill. So this is what the allocation of this time to the skills. Now, allocating times to the managerial functions. Allocating times to the managerial functions. There is one management wheel, you know, which starts with planning, organizing, directing, staffing, controlling, and again going to planning. So that is a vicious circle of management, managerial functions. Thereafter, all these managerial functions is having another outer circle as such, which may be covering marketing, personnel, production, R&D, personnel, and administration. So that is the outer circle. There may be further outer circles which may be covering the outer environment or macro environment, like political factors, technical factors, economic factors, or religious and other psychological factors, etc. Thereafter, maybe the lithospheres, atmosphere, biosphere, and such like things. So that is extra environmental circle as such. But we are more concerned with allocating time of the managerial functions and to the different functional areas like marketing, personnel, production, and finance. Here in this diagram, we have kept analyzing management functions by organizational level. How much planning is needed at different levels? How much organizing, staffing is needed? How much directing is needed? And how much control is needed at different hierarchical levels? So at the present, we are seeing this upper one only. That is the managerial functions. Now at the lower level in planning, lesser space is provided, whereas at the middle and top, it is maximum at the top level of the hierarchy. They are to devote more time in planning. Whereas organizing and staffing is provided equal space as such, so equal time is to be devoted for organizing and staffing at all the hierarchical levels, lower to top management. Similarly, directing is the principle, is the managerial function, which requires maximum time, because you need maximum instructions to be given to the workers at the lower management, and you are in direct touch with the workers, as the lower this first line supervisor may be requiring maximum efforts to be devoted for communicating and giving instruction to the workers. But this direction may be getting lesser at the top, because your contact with the workers goes lesser when you are at the top. Chairman will be meeting the persons, workers, very rarely as such, once in a year or something like that. What the first line supervisor is directing time and again, communicating, motivating, and leading the persons again and again. Control, on the other hand, is less at the lower level, but it goes on increasing. Space provided for it is increasing. So time required for control is more at the top, because they are overall in charge of the organization. There are so many wings in the organization, and hence control function or supervision function increases at the top. So this is what this managerial functions and allocating time to managerial function. Now coming to the lower diagram, which is shown on the same transparency. Managerial time cone, it is called. Managerial time cone is shown here in this pyramid, and these are the managerial wheels or management wheels. This is another management wheel, this is another management wheel. At three hierarchical level, three management wheels are shown. Now it is, these wheels, as I told you, shows the functions or contains the function of production, marketing, finance, R&D, personnel, administration, etc. Similarly, in all the three levels, there are functions like this associated. All the functions are associated. Managerial functions are outside this or inside this. They are also associated with each marketing as well as finance. You have to do planning, organizing, directing, and staffing and controlling at all the levels. Now, if we see at the lower management, how much time is needed for operating and how much time is needed for managing. These are the two functions, because human skills are equally needed. In the earlier diagram, we have seen it. And hence, operating and managing are the two functions which are very important. So, operating is 70% time is needed at the transactional level or at the operational level or at the level of the lower management. But it may be 30% of the time is needed for managing, really managing the things. In the middle management level, operating needs 50%, managing needs 50%. At the top management, operating needs 30%, because they are hardly in touch with the machines and other things, because they are not operating as such, but they are managing. So hence 70% of the time goes to managing or should be allocated to managing. This is about the allocation of the time to management.
Viewers, in this part of the film, you have been shown the basic concepts of time management, which include the myths regarding time management, the importance of time, and the allocation of time for different managerial functions. In the next part of the film, you will be shown how to use a time log for effectively managing time for executive purposes. It will also outline the major time wasters and the ways in which these can be tackled.